Everyone, we want to welcome you to our first Sunday service in 2022. This is our first service that we will be doing online, and we are looking forward, you know, to having more services in person as we started this year. So I just want to welcome you all. I mean, I know most of you are still enjoying your holidays, but we also welcome those who are, you know, joining us online. You know, who are not our members, who have just joined us. We want to welcome you to our service. So this year, we have decided to focus on the theme of restoration. The same theme of restoration, I will show you how it fits into our services and even our mission as a church. Of course, this theme is very, very important, you know, as we emerge from the current pandemic that is causing huge impact in our lives, spiritually, socially, materially, and otherwise. You see, whenever humanity suffers losses, God's divine intervention is needed to bring about restoration. So now, the word restoration implies a return to a former original. That is the dictionary meaning. You know, it means a return to a former or original or normal or unimpaired condition or the restitution of something taken away or lost. So as I've said, that this is really in line with our vision as a church. You know, as you remember, our vision as a church is that we want to become a vessel of God. That is a vessel of God transforming lives and impacting nations. So this is the vision of our church. And then it is based on the book of John chapter 7, verse 38, which is the key verse to our ministry. So which says here, whoever believes in me, as scriptures has said, rivers of living water will flow from within them. So this is our understanding of transformation. When we talk about transforming lives, so really to us, it's bringing a revival in people's lives. And not just revival in people's lives, but also in revival among nations that, you know, it comes from God. So this is our vision. And now I just want to show you our mission, where our restoration fits in. Now, our restoration mission, we always work with the 4R. We believe that our mission is to usher God's end time revival. We usher God's end time revival through the 4Rs. The 4Rs here, the first one is the regeneration. Regeneration, this is the renewal of people's lives. So transformation begins when people really come to God and they have their lives being renewed. A regeneration of their spirits takes place. So we believe very much that revival restart or transformation starts with the change in the spirit of man or in the heart of man. And then now, of course, revival comes when really God pours out his spirit into people's lives. And then, of course, this results into the reformation, the change of character of a person. And of course, now the change of character eventually leads to restoration. So we work with the four R's. So we have been talking much about revival. We've been talking about, regeneration or renewal of people's lives, but we haven't yet spoken much about restoration. So as I said, this year is a very, very good opportunity for us to focus more on restoration. Restoration, and the Bible here, this message of restoration today, I'm basing it on the book of Acts chapter 3, verse 20 to 21. Acts chapter 3, verse 20 to 21, which says here, and that he may send, this was Peter preaching. He says here, and that he may send Jesus Christ, who was preached to you before. Verse 21, it says, whom heaven must receive until the times of restoration of all things which God has spoken by the mouth of his holy prophets since the world began. So I like it in the Amplified Version. Amplified Version, it says here, whom heaven, that is verse 21, whom heaven must keep until the time for the complete restoration of all things about which God promised through the mouth of his holy prophets and from the ancient times. Now, the message of restoration is very, very key here. And although we are focusing on the year, the theme of this year is the restoration of all things. Restoration of all things. It's not just some of the things. We believe here, as Peter was preaching, he says here, the heavens will keep Jesus. That means now Jesus is not going to come back before the restoration of all things. Now, if you look here, how things is God is working. God is working towards the restoration of all things progressively. According to God's plan, things are being restored each day. Each day is a season for the restoration of things of God. So things are being restored progressively. Now, this is totally different. As I've already said, that we have just really, we're still in the middle of the pandemic, where there are so many losses. I mean, people were accounting their losses. We have lost our beloved ones. We have lost many, many things. I mean, we've lost businesses. People have lost many, many things. And some people are saying now, this really means it's the end. When people are losing things, when people's lives are being lost, to some people, this seems that now we are moving towards the end. And the Bible never said that the end, the world is going to end, or Jesus is going to come when people have lost lives, when people have lost businesses. That's not our God's plan. According to God's plan, Jesus will come when there is restoration of all things. So I want you to underline this, because now this is the theme of this year. This is what we are going to talk about, I mean, in this church. This is what we are going to pray about. This is what we are going to preach. This is what we are going to live, not just talk about. We are going to live this kind of experiences. Now, this year, 2022, I mean, even people who are not believers, you know, when they say the symbolic number itself, you know, the number 22 already shows that now this is the year of hope. This is the year of multiplications. This is the year of greater recovery that we are going to have. So this year, we are going to focus here in our church, Rivers of Life Ministries. God is going to unleash, is going to release ministries that is going to accelerate God's restoration. So, the restoration of all things, this is definitely what God wants us to do. Now, I just want us to base my message of restoration today as I make this introduction, as I said. You know, last year, we declared last year as a year of greater glory. And we have seen the glory of God. We've seen the greater glory of God in our services. But this year, we are declaring it. Now, there is a difference about, you know, from just expressing a wishful thinking. You know, many people are that I've met, they are saying, we are hoping that this year is going to be a very, you know, we are just hoping. We just wish that this year becomes better. We just wish that 2022 is not like 2021 and 2020. We are wishing, we are hoping. You know, I mean, this does not change anything. Wishing does not change anything. Some people individually, you are looking at yourself, you are saying, you know, I wish this year will be different. I wish this year will not be like 2021. I wish this year, you know, will be better than what I've experienced before. So it is not what we wish. It is not what we wish. It's not just the wishes. It is what you declare right from the beginning. Some people are making resolutions. You know, I'm resolving this year to do what was. So what we are talking here now, we are not just talking about a resolution here. We are giving a declaration. We are making a declaration. We are declaring that this year, 2022, it is a year of greater, it is a year of restoration of all things. We are accelerating the restoration of all things that Peter preached about, that heaven will keep Jesus until the restoration of Jesus. If we want to accelerate, if we want to accelerate the second coming of Jesus, we have to accelerate the restoration of all things. So what does that mean? Things, as I've said, restoration means now when things are brought back into their original state. God's aim is that this planet, God, humanity, will be reinstated, will be brought to its original state, its glorious state. Human beings will be restored to their glorious, their original state. Now, you know, God is interested in restoring, in bringing us back to our original state. God wants to see man, the man that he has created in the Garden of Eden, being fully restored. That man who walked in the garden, that woman who walked in the Garden of Eden with the glory of God, who was covered by the glory of God to a point where even though he has got no clothes, even when Adam and Eve were not clothed, people would see the glory of God. So the glory of God is going to be seen here on earth, not just in heaven. People are going to look at some individuals that God has fully restored them here on earth. And without anything, without putting on expensive clothes, people will look at them and just see the glory of God. So we are being restored every day. God is restoring people. God is restoring individuals. God is restoring not just people, but also nations, also countries. God is restoring nations to their glorious state. Even the same thing that we hope for in South Africa is for us to be restored to that. Now, I just want to read the base what I'm going to talk now in the book. There are two books that I'm going to share. It's the book of Luke and the book of Isaiah. The book of Luke and the book of Isaiah, which, you know, when the first part that we read here, the Luke chapter 4, verse 14 to 21. Now, here it says here, Jesus returned to Galilee in the power of the Spirit. Underline the power of the Spirit. And news about him spread through the whole countryside. Now, and then verse 15 says, he was teaching in their synagogue, and everyone praised him. Verse 16, it says, he went to Nazareth, where he had been brought up. And on the Sabbath day, he went into the synagogue, as was his custom. He stood up to read. Verse 17, it says, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah, which we are going to read later in detail, Isaiah chapter 61, verse 1, going onwards. So I'll read it later after this one. Then it says here, he was handed this book of Isaiah scroll. It was written on a kind of a skin. I mean, that's how they didn't have paper things that we have today. They were using writing on the skin. Now, he unrolled this. So he found the place where it was written. That is Isaiah chapter 61, which is now. Now, verse 18 says here, now, in this book of Isaiah, it was written, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to proclaim the good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to set the oppressed free. And what I like here, which is key to my message today and key to the theme of this year, it says here, verse 19, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. To proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. In other translation versions, it says here, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. Proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. Now, this I've said to you now. Jesus came back. You know, that was after he was baptized by the Holy Spirit. And then he went into the wilderness. And there he was fasting for 40 days and 40 nights. And as he was fasting there, then all the temptations, after he has faced the devil, and after he's overcome the temptation, the Bible says he returned now when he started his ministry. Now, listen what Jesus was talking about here. When he started his ministries, he was preaching the good news. The good news, really, it was not just salvation. It was the good news of the restoration of man. It was the good news of the restoration that people will experience. And then he came to Nazareth, where he grew up. The Bible says he grew up here. And in Nazareth, when he was, so he went into a synagogue. One day, when he was in the synagogue, he was given a scroll to read. Now, he opened up this book of Isaiah, which to me is very, very key to what we are saying this year is a year of restoration. Now, in this book of Isaiah, now he says here, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to proclaim. To proclaim is to announce officially, to make a statement, to make a declaration. You know, when you declare something, now, you know, here you can see there's a difference. He says here, he has anointed me. You know, the Spirit of the Lord first is upon me. It is the Spirit of the Lord that is driving me to say what I'm saying. It is the anointing of God. It's the anointing. God has set me apart to do what I'm doing here. So that's why, you know, when we are taking a theme for each year, we are not just doing this lightly. We are not just doing this because it's fashionable that, you know, as a church, you must have a theme for yourself. Sometimes even at individual level, you know, you decide what will be the main focus of this year. So when we God led me to this topic, you know, that we focus much on the topic of restoration. You know, the topic of restoration, God put it upon me, you know, that, you know, we spoke about the glory of the Lord. But the glory of the Lord, God, how do we get glorified? We are glorified when God restores things into our lives, when God restores our lives and so on. So Jesus said here, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. That's what he was saying. That's what Isaiah prophesied. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, you know, he has is upon me, that means he drives me. The Spirit of the Lord is driving me now, is leading me now. And then he says now, he has anointed me to proclaim, that is verse 19, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. The year of the Lord's favor. The year, the acceptable year of the Lord. Now, restoration and favor goes together. Restoration and favor goes together. Now, it is through the favor of God that, you know, when God's favor is upon your life, restoration happens because of one word only, because of the favor of the Lord. We need the favor of the Lord when we are going through difficult situations. We need the favor of God when physically we are not able to, you know, to regain what you have lost. So as I've said, 2021, 2022, many people have lost their beloved ones. Many people have lost businesses. Many people have lost many, many other things that they have lost. So Nazareth here also, it was a poor city. It was a poor city. You know, when you read about Nazareth, when you read about, people will laugh about Nazareth. Can anything good come from Nazareth? Can anything good from this? It was known to become a poor city. But Jesus started his ministry from that city, which was poor, because he grew up in that city. So it is not really, when he got there, he was ministering about the favor of God. The favor of God, I'm here to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. So that means now the year of the Lord's favor. There are other years, he was saying to Nazareth, there are years that were not really acceptable to you. There were years that, you know, to you, they were not really good years, but this is the year of acceptable years. So I'm talking to someone today who is saying to me, Pastor, I really had a very difficult year last year. It was not a good year. I've lost many relatives. I've lost friends. I've lost, you know, family members. Someone who is saying, you know, I've lost my business last year. I've lost, you know, this is what I've lost. I've sometimes lost my studies. Someone who is saying, I was negatively affected last year. And this year, I'm just looking forward. I don't know what is going to happen. I don't know what the year is going to be. And churches have also been really affected in various ways. And many churches closed down. But now, they are saying this year, we are waiting to see what really is going to happen this year. We are going to wait to see what God is going to do this year. But Jesus coming to Nazareth, he was not coming just expressing the hope that Nazareth will become better. You know, if you just live in hope without really having the Spirit of the Lord within you, without having the anointing of the Lord within you, you are not going to be able to overcome. You are not going to break the bed. You are not going to remove the yokes that really the pandemic has brought to us. But here, Jesus said, I'm here to declare, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. And we are here today, you know, as Rivers of Life Ministries, this is our message to this year. We are going to declare, we are declaring as we stand here, we are proclaiming, you know, that 2022 is an acceptable year of the Lord. 2022, it is not just our year. It is not really the year of our plans. It is the year of the Lord. I want you to join me in this declaration and saying, we declare, you know, we declare. When you declare under the anointing of the Lord, when you declare under the leadership being led by the Holy Spirit, when we declare, things happen. When God himself in the book of Genesis, you know, he declared things. The Bible says there was nothing. The earth was formless. The earth was, you know, but through the declaration, through the word of God, using the word of God, who is Jesus, when God was declaring things, you know, order came to be. Things came to be. The emptiness that was there came to be. Everything came through the declaration. Some people might be asking, how God is going to restore things? God cannot restore my business. God cannot restore, you know, the people that God have demonstrated in history, in the Bible, how he restored things that were lost. How he restored things that really were lost, and God restored them. Now, I just want quickly to move into the book of Isaiah so that I should link it up with what Jesus was saying here. Now, if you read the book of Isaiah chapter 61, because here Peter just took a small passage and quoted that passage in the book of Acts. But now, when you go back now to this book that Jesus read, I mean, the whole scripture, the whole chapter is full of how restoration takes place. Now, if you read verse 61, it says here, that is Isaiah chapter 61 from verse 1, it says, the Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is on me because the Lord has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom to the captives, to release from darkness for the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn, to provide for those who grieve in Zion, to bestow on them a crown of beauty instead of ashes, and the oil of joy instead of mourning, and the garment of praise instead of the spirit of despair. They will be called oaks of righteousness, a planting of the Lord for the display of his splendor. You know why God restores things? God was just showing how he's going to restore the nation of Israel, you know, from captivity in Babylon, when everything in Jerusalem was completely disseminated when they were taken into captivity. Everything was destroyed, including the temple. Everything was really burned down to ashes. No single soul remained there. But I want to tell you, you know, God was speaking through the prophet of his prophet Isaiah and talking about this coming of restoration, that Israel is going to be restored back to its original nature. It says now, God is going to do this now. God is treating the nation of Israel as his planting, the planting of the Lord for the display of his splendor. Why God restores things into our lives? It is not just for the sake of our own benefit. God restores things so that now, you know, he can display in us his splendor. He can show, you know, as I said, his glory. He can glorify himself. Why does God restore to us things to us? Because God wants to restore. He wants to glorify us. You know, I said, you know, the Bible says, you know, to them that God really, you know, have foreknew, those that he have shown his favor, he has called them, and not just called them, he justified them, and not justified them, he also glorified them. Why does God glorify? God glorified them so that he must display his splendor. God's splendor need to be displayed. Now, when people have gone through the kind of situation, so here you can see here, the Bible is showing the nation of Israel has gone through many, many situations when they were in slavery. So the Bible is saying, you know, the good news to the poor, those who have got nothing, there's good news to them. So he says here, you know, there are people who, because of captivity, they are poor. There are people who, because of whatever happens, they are brokenhearted. There are people who have lost their freedom and they've been kept captives right now. You know, there are people who have really, you know, I mean, have become, you know, prisoners. They're in the darkness of they've become prisoners. There are people really, you know, who are under difficult situations and so on and so on. You see, but the Bible says restoration means that now you are brought out, you are singled out of a particular situation that you find yourself now, and then you are put back to where you belong. Now, as I said, you know, many people have been displaced. We have been displaced in various ways from our original positions. Maybe it could be materially, maybe it could be spiritually, maybe it could be physically. But, you know, restoration means that now we are going to be reinstated. We are going to be brought back to our position where we are able to show the glory of God, where we are able to show the splendor of God. So God here was saying so many things that is going to happen to the nation of Israel. Now he says to them, you see, when restoration happens, he says now, the nation of Israel will rebuild ancient ruins. Now, you know, when restoration comes to a nation, the nation is able to stand up and rebuild that which has been destroyed. It doesn't matter whether it's for 70 years. I mean, they've been in captivity for over 70 years, but it doesn't matter how many years, you know. So we are just talking about here maybe 2 years that people have suffered losses and so on. But God is saying whatever that has been destroyed will be rebuilt. Now, this will be saying now Israel will rebuild ancient ruins, and God will restore the places long devastated. No, not just 2 years, devastated in 2 years, but the places that has been long devastated. Now, that is restoration. He says now, they will renew the ruined cities. Now, they are cities. You know, I kept on joking that, you know, I see myself, I mean, the city of God. We are the cities of God. When we move around, we are not just ordinary people. We are the city of God. We are the temple of God. The Bible says God will renew and the ruined cities will be rebuilt. The ruined individuals will be rebuilt. And that have been those cities. No, this is saying now, how is it going to happen? Strangers will go to shepherd your flocks. So people that they have never known, how is this restoration going to happen? I'm telling you, the Bible says here with Israel, it says the strangers, people that they have never, we are going to look after their flocks, will shepherd their flocks. The foreigners will work in their fields and their vineyards. You know, I mean, look, the foreigners and the labor will not come from them. The labor will be provided by God. And it says, you will be called priests of the Lord. You will be named ministers of our God. You will feed on the wealth of nations, and in their riches you will boast. I mean, you know, say amen, someone. You know, this is what God was just declaring. These are declarations through the prophet of the prophet Isaiah. And this whole passage was affirmed by Jesus when he was talking to Nazareth. In other words, now what was prophesied for the whole nation of Israel, Jesus was prophesied using the same prophecy now for Nazareth. So what does that mean? Nazareth was supposed to be fully restored. Nazareth was supposed to be transformed into a city of splendor. And how will that happen? How? Not because of its own effort. That will happen when there are people provided to transform the city, when there will be wealth, when Nazareth will be feeding on the wealth of the nations. So now, I don't know. You know, the Bible says God, you know, what does God do? He takes the wealth of the non-believers, the wealth from the non-believers, and give it to the believers. That is God's redistribution. We have been struggling in this country to find mechanisms, ways of redistributing wealth so that our inequality gap that is really unparalleled in the whole world, this should be overcome. We've been trying to find a way. How do you deal with inequality? But there is a divine, there is really a supernatural way also that happened on the spiritual realm. That redistribution of wealth does not only happen physically as we see it, but here the Bible is talking about here that the nations, the nation of Israel, which has become impoverished, which has become destroyed, which have lost its city Jerusalem, which that city will be restored, everything will be restored. But how this will happen, that is where I'm telling you, that is where you need divine intervention in your life. That's where we need God's favor. The difference between Israel here at that time and the other nations is that now Israel was really had the lost favor. The favor of the Lord was upon the nation of Israel. And that's why God is saying now, when the favor of the God is on the nation of Israel, this nation is going to emerge out of its ruins. It's going to emerge out of its greater devastation for many years. It's going to emerge and it's going to become a wealthy nation. It's going to emerge out of those ruins or those of the ashes. It's going to emerge from ashes and its people will become glorious. Now, this is the kind of, you know, when we talk about, you know, the prophecy, when we talk about, forth-telling, this is the good news. This is the good news. When we say to our nation, it doesn't matter we're black, green, yellow, we need to say to our people are going to emerge of, you know, the ruins, the devastations that has been caused by the pandemic. Our people are going to emerge from the systems, the colonialism, all the kind of systems that real people have suffered for many, many years, that our nation is going to emerge out of those things, because now we are in a new era. We are in a new season. This is the season of restoration. God is restoring all things. God is restoring all things. And this only happens simply because God has started a new year. A new year to God is not just 12 months. A new year to God could be many, another 1,000 years to come. This is a new year to God. God is a God of new things. He's saying, look, I'm doing a new thing. I'm doing a new thing, and that new thing is springing forth already. Forget about the former things. Forget about things of the old and think of really things of the future. Things of this new thing. Look at the new things that I'm doing. And God is doing restoration. What will change the lives of our people? What will change the life of our young people? What will change the life of the oppressed? The life of the oppressed people? The life of the poor? It is not just what government will do. It will be the transformation that comes from inside. The restoration. God here was declaring restoration over the nation of Israel. Isaiah was prophesying what is going to happen. And Jesus came and also emphasized that now, that prophecy was not just for Israel. The prophecy of restoration is the prophecy of all humanity. That Jesus
God, Jesus has come to fulfill that prophecy. And not just to fulfill it, to make sure that, you know, Peter, as he was preaching, that the restoration of all things, because Jesus came to fulfill the prophecy which Isaiah has prophesied, the restoration of the nation of Israel and every from its devastation. But now Jesus has come to fulfill that scripture, and not just to fulfill. Now the Bible says now Jesus has started the fulfillment of that scripture, and says heaven will keep Jesus. Heaven will keep Jesus until the day of, you know, the day of full restoration of all things. Now, God is in the business of restoring things that have been lost. God is in the business of restoring the cities that have been. God is in the process of even restoring the whole earth. That's what the Bible now, when you read the Bible, it really puts you, already project you to see what God is doing. God is already thinking of the new earth. He's thinking of new heaven. The Bible tells us that the earth in which we are living in, we are working hard 24 hours building the cities, but the Bible already told us that all these things will be destroyed. When they are being destroyed, now a new heaven, a new earth shall emerge. A new heaven, a new earth is going to come over. So God is already in the process of restoring, you know, the new earth. But God is in the now. What God is doing is to restore the citizens of that new earth. God is restoring the citizens. God is preparing the inhabitants of the new earth that God is fully restoring. So now, when you read here, the Bible tells us now, you see, the question is now, if I have lost something, if I have lost a business, how is this going to happen? How is God going to do it? How is God going to restore that which I've lost? So in the Bible, I've given, there are numerous, many, many examples that God have showed how God does restoration. The other time I ministered here, if you look at the life of Job, Job lost everything. God, the Bible says he lost everything. He lost all the possessions. He lost the children. He lost everything. He lost everything. The Bible tells us that now, even his health, he lost his health. The only thing that was spared was his soul, his spirit. His spirit was the only one that could not be lost. It's the only one where God has put all his things. And the Bible tells us, shows you how Job, you know, how Job was fully restored. How everything that Job lost was restored. Not just, it was restored, multiplied. It was doubled. Everything that he had before, if it was wealth, it was doubled. If it was everything that he had, it was a double. If he has chemists, the chemists were doubled. You know, when God restores things, God, when he restores, he doubles things that we have lost. So when we talk about this restoration, we are talking about here something that, you know, Isaiah spoke about, and Jesus also affirmed, and Peter preached about the restoration of all things. You know, the churches, the church of God shall be restored to its former glory. I want to tell you, Jesus is not coming back. He's not coming back to a church that is harassed, a church that is downtrodden, a church that is poor, a church that has got no building, a church that has got no sound. It's not coming back to a harassed church. Jesus is coming to a glorious church. That's what the Bible tells us now. You know, he is coming. You know, he's coming to take his bride, that the church will look like it's a bride, will be fully restored to its glory. You know, when somebody is about to marry, you know, when a lady is preparing herself to get married, you know, she pitches herself to the highest level to reveal her glory, so that when you look at her, you see the glory of nature. You see what, you know, everything. So the church, like a bride, when the bridegroom, who is Jesus, comes back, the Bible tells us that now the church shall be glorious. The church shall be glorious. You look at the church and then you will see the splendor of God. Now, people are saying, no, the church is going down. The church, no, the church is fully restored to its former glory. The church is fully restored. It's not just rivers of life, but the God is in the process of restoring. It's restored. If there's something that has been assured, that will live, will exist forever, that is the church of God. The church of God, the church of God is being fully restored. God. Every day we stand here, the church of God is being fully restored. The church of God is being fully restored to its glory, its former glory. And the Bible says, the splendor of the Lord shall display. The church will display the splendor. Now, As I said, you know, here with Israel, how are they going to, what's going to happen? Strangers, you know, he said, strangers will shepherd your flock. The people that you have never known, how will your business be restored? How will you get back your business? I don't know. I'm telling you, some strangers will work on your business. Some strangers will provide support that you need. People that you have never known here. Here the Bible says, the foreigners will work on your fields. The foreigners, you know, people that you have never known, Israel, these are the people who will come and work on your fields and restore your vineyards. They will restore your fields. They will restore your vineyards. That means now you are going to produce more. But how you are going to produce more? Not because of your own capacity, but capacity will come from somewhere. So the same thing, you know, Rivers of Life, you know, as we are talking about. This year is a year of restoration. Now, restoration means here, there will be a lot of work. If you have seen here, there is deliverance that is needed. There is a healing that is needed. Many healings should happen here. There should be miracles. There will be many, many things that's going to happen. Now, where do you get capacity for that? The Bible says to the nation of Israel, although they are fewer in numbers, because maybe some might have died in slavery, but he says here, you are going to have more than enough capacity. You are going to have more than enough capacity. There will be strangers. There will be foreigners. All these things, God will be. And then he says, you will be named minister of our God. You will feed on the wealth of nations. And in their riches, you will boast. Amen. Now, you know, listen here. Where God does not throw money from heaven, doesn't throw money. You'll never see money flying coming down here. But the Bible says God circulates. God can direct where money should go to. We need money for what we're going to do. We need money to do revivals. We need money, you know, to do our. We need money, all those things. But the Bible says here, what does he say here? He says here, you will feed on the wealth of nations. Not just nations. When we're talking about, you know, impacting nations. Now, someone is asking, how will you impact nations? How will you fly to other nations? How you go to the Middle East? How you go to Central Africa? How will you go to India? How will you go into those things? God is saying that, you know, we will feed on the wealth of nations. God, the wealth is already here. The wealth to support the ministry is already here. The wealth to support your business is already here. But the Bible says now, it is through the favor of God. When God's favor is upon your life, it attracts favor, it attracts support, even from the people that you have never thought that they can support your business. It supports, you will never know why people are choosing you. Some of you, you're entrepreneurs, you are doing businesses, but you are saying, Pastor, how am I going to get the resources? You know, the favor of God always attracts. It attracts, you know, support. The favor of God is always attracts a special treatment over yourself. It also attracts something. It's got a magnet that always pulls something over to you. So here, the Bible tells us now, Israel, because of this favor, they will attract capacity. There will be strangers coming to work for them. They will have foreigners coming to work for them. And again, they are a magnet of the wealth of the nations. The wealth of the nations, people will come and put money, will come and put their wealth in the nation, over the nation of Israel. You know, and he says here, you know, and in their riches, you will boast. Not, you know, in the riches of the world. The world will bring resources. You know, when we are standing here, you know, the buildings that we need buildings. When we talk about these things, God says when the favor of God is really upon a person. You know, I mean, I will just give you an example. When Israel spent over 40 years in Egypt, you know, in slavery. They were treated as slaves there. They never really had time to make gold. But I'm telling you, when they were about to leave, God said to Moses that, you know, this your people, we let them talk to their neighbors. And when they talk to their neighbors, because of the favor now, the favor that they have is going to attract the wealth of the Egyptians. The Egyptians is going to give them gold, is going to give them whatever, you know, valuable resources, is going to give them minerals. And that's exactly happened like that. When Israelites left Egypt, they left Egypt with a lot of gold, which were given to them by the Egyptians who were oppressing them. You know, this is what happens. You know, when God's favor is upon your life, your oppressor becomes your blesser. The person, your persecutor, your oppressor, the person who wanted to see your business going down is the one who become eventually your supporter. The person who have been putting down for years, when the favor of God is upon you, I'm telling you, things changes. Israel people received lots of favors from the Egyptians who have been oppressing them for many years. But when it was a time for God to release them, when it was times of God's favor, when the year of the Lord's favor was upon the nation of Israel, they left Egypt with a lot of gold which were given to them, lots of minerals which were given them, lots of products that were given to them by the Egyptians people. Now, what are we talking about here? Restoration is not just a natural thing. Restoration is a supernatural act. Restoration is not a natural act. It's a supernatural act which can translate itself into natural activities that we can see with our naked eyes here. Now, here it says here, the nation of Israel will feed, even today, when you talk about, I don't want to go into politics, but when you look at the nation of Israel now, materially, it's still right in the desert, but it's a nation that is prosperous, that somewhere, somehow, one can see there was somehow a divine intervention. And then it says here, now, instead of shame, the nation of Israel will receive a double portion. You know, 2 years ago, we declared 2020, that 2020 is a year of double portion. And I'm telling you, there were many members of our church who really got doubled, our church, we received a double portion of blessings, and many other people, really in their businesses, they did very well. They received a double portion in that year, 2020, when other people are saying it was a bad year, it was the worst year. I want to tell you, to some of our members here, it was a year of prosperity. Many people got so many things. They say, instead of disgrace, you will rejoice in your inheritance. Instead of, you will inherit a double portion in your land, and everlasting joy will be yours. So I can go on and on and on with what here God was saying here. But I just want to conclude by saying, what does restoration mean? To us, really, restoration means the Lord's favor. The Lord's favor. It is when God's favor is upon you, things are restored. Things are restored in a very supernatural way, things that we have never seen. Now, this year, God is saying to us here is Rivers of Life Ministry, there will be greater restorations of lives. People will be restored individually. We will talk about these things, how you can be restored. Some of you, it can be restored in your personal life. You can be restored even in your family life. You can be restored in all the areas that you have affected. You can be restored also in your ministry. Some of you, your ministries have been affected. We will show you how you can be fully restored. And some of you who might be listening here might say, Pastor, yes, I know. This is what I used to do for God. Because of this and that, I found myself, my ministry, maybe my church was shut down and so on. But I want to say to you now, I'm declaring the favor of the Lord upon you. I'm declaring the favor of the Lord upon your business. I'm declaring the favor of the Lord upon your family, upon your church. I'm declaring all these things, and I'm saying this is the year that we really need to look to God. We need to look to God's favor. We need to look to God on what God says. We're not saying that, we need to be ignorant, that we're not able to do things on our own. But in as much as we are going to be doing what we can do with our own natural abilities, we need to trust also that God is there to support us. God's blessings is upon God's favor. We are doing these things. God's favor is upon us. So there are four steps for that I always talk about, that for restoration to happen, there are five things that I want really to just to conclude with. So we need to have faith. Why am I talking about it? We are declaring. Now, once we declare that is the year of restoration, we need to stand up as a church and have faith. Faith, remember, is the having the substance, of things that are hoped for. Faith is having the evidence of things that we are hoping for. So this kind of restoration, this kind of, the glory that we're talking about, this kind of restoration that we're talking about, it is something that we must see. We must have the substance of these things. It's not just talking. Now, we need to be humble enough. The second thing is humility. We really need to be humble enough. We need to have to humble ourselves. We need to submit. That's what Nazareth was expected to do. Nazareth was supposed, to humble itself. When Jesus was talking to Nazareth, that God is going to do restoration in the nation of Israel, in Nazareth. What they should have done was to say, we humble ourselves. But instead of being humbling themselves, you see them standing up, very angry, taking Jesus, and they wanted to throw Jesus down the cliff, just for Jesus to tell them that, the year of the Lord's favor is upon them. But they wanted to destroy Jesus. Jesus for that. They wanted to throw him down the cliff. And then we need to pray. You know, prayer is very, very important. We'll be starting again with our prayer and fast, you know, mid-January until mid-February. We'll be doing our prayer and fast. We're not just talking about restoration. Restoration happens when the nation pray. We are going to lift our hands, you know, to God and pray for this restoration of this year of the Lord's favor. So there will be prayer. So when you come back to you come back here mid-January, those who will come earlier, please come and join. Those who come in February, they will join the tail end of our prayer and fast. Of course, we go to that. The fourth one is repentance. You know, one needs to repent. We, you know, where we have gone wrong, we will go to God. You know, for us to be fully restored, we need to humble ourselves so that God should really restore us to our glorious position. We go to God in repentance. And then the last thing that we are going to talk about also this year, you know, it is, you know, all people who are fully restored in the Bible, they were restored when they were, you know, when they were giving. You know, when the offering, when they were giving an offering to God, God restored when people were giving an offering to God. Now, if you look when you look at Noah, the Bible tells us that God spared Noah and then he saved Noah. But after the flood, Noah came down. But coming down, there was no restoration. Things were still dead. There was still a lot of things that were really not okay. You know, but the Bible say God only promised to restore everything that was there before to Noah. After Noah has made a sacrifice, Noah made a sacrifice to God. And after he has given a sacrifice to God, and God after has enjoyed the sacrifice, then God started to say, you know, Noah, he began to bless Noah. Again, Adamic blessings, the blessings that were pronounced declared in the Garden of Eden. Now, they were again declared over Noah. That is God is going to, you know, go, this is going to happen. You know, they be fruitful, be multiplied, fill the earth, you know, fill the earth, dominate it. All those declarations that were made in the Garden of Eden were again reinstated to Noah, were again spoken over, you know, to Noah. And I'm telling you, after that, the Bible says Noah was able to fill the earth. Today, the earth is over 7 billion people. And that 7 billion people came from one family. One family that was saved, you know, from the flood. That one family is the one that have resulted to over 7 billion people that we are having today. Over 7 billion people that came from there. But the trigger to this blessing was when Noah gave an offering. When God gave an offering. Now I can give you another example. You know, the trigger for the restoration to Job. Job restoration, the Bible says, it happens when Job was giving an offering. Job had nothing. He had got no money. He lost everything until a friend came to him and they gave him something. They gave an offering to him. And Job took that offering which was given to him. Instead of using it for himself, he took that offering and used it to make an offering to God. And the moment he gave that offering, the Bible say that triggered God's restorative power. And the Bible say after that, you know, that offering triggered God's restoration. And from there, God restored everything and so on. So this is something that we're going to talk about this year also. That, you know, your offerings, the offerings that you give to God, they are giving to God, triggers. Some of you, your business is completely at zero. You can look at your balance bank, you are left maybe with 100 rand. But I want to tell you, when you give an offering to God, I'm not saying this because we need money, but we are saying when you give something to God, that giving triggers something. That triggers restoration power. So this is what something that we're going to talk about. So these are five things that you always need to bear in mind this year when we talk about restoration. Think of faith. Think that we need to have humility. Think about the prayer that we will always be continuing with our prayers, all kinds of prayers, fasting, all kinds of prayers that we'll be doing. Of course, we'll always go to God in repentance every day. You know, repenting from where we have gone wrong, and also then the offerings that we're going to do. The giving and the offering, all these things goes together, you know, for God to restore our lives. So may God bless you. So I want to conclude now. You know, I don't know when I'm talking about restoration. Already we have started, you know, you have seen, this is the theme of the year. This is the theme, restoration of all things. restoration of all things. God wants restoration of all things. Anything that the devil has taken from you. You see, in the book of John chapter 10, verse 10, it says here, Jesus was saying, the devil, the enemy has come to destroy, has come to steal, has come to kill. But I have come so that you might have life in abundance. You know, abundance means that fully restoration. All the things that the devil has taken, stolen from you. All the things that the devil has destroyed in your life. All things that the devil has killed. You know, the Bible says, Jesus said, I've come to restore all those things so that you might have life and have life in abundance. So this is what we believe. We believe that God is going to take us out. God is going to take us out from unemployment. God is going to take us out from the situation that we are. Somebody might be saying, yes, that's just wishful thinking. This is not wishful thinking. This is what we are declaring over ourselves. This is what I'm declaring over myself. This is what I'm declaring over myself for 2022. I'm declaring, you know, the restoration of all things in my life. And I want you to do the same thing, to join me as we're going to pray. Declare restoration of all things. I don't know which things that you have lost, but I want you just to stand up and say, I might have lost a job. I'm declaring the restoration of my job. And I want to tell you, God is going to double that job. God is going to give you something that is two times. You might have lost money. I just want to stand up and say, you know, I'm declaring the restoration of the money that I've lost. I'm declaring the restoration of my business. I'm declaring the restoration. You know, it doesn't matter. I don't know what you have lost, but I don't want you just to sit in wishful thinking that this year it's just going to be difficult, different on its own. You got to declare things. You got to stand up and declare things over your life. So may God bless you as we look forward again. You know, next week we'll let you know if we'll be in person here or we'll be online. But I just want to wish you well and just say to you, start declaring things over yourself. This is the year of greater restoration. We are going to see signs and wonders. We are going to see miracles when God is restoring people, when God is healing lives, when God is transforming lives. This is a year of greater restoration. Restorations of all things. Restoration of all things. I just want to begin to say, write it everywhere. This year is my year of restoration. Some of you, you have been weak in your Christian life. You can just say, this is a year that I'm going to be fully restored. Some of you, your ministries were really suffering. Stand up and declare, this is the year. This is my year of my ministry. This is the year where the Bible says in the book of Isaiah, I will be called a minister of God. I'm be called the minister of God. That's what God said. Jesaiah said to the Israel that you will be called the ministers of God. You'll be called. People will look at you and say, you are ministers of God. So those of you who maybe have trouble problem with the ministries, I want to tell you, this year is a year of your restoration. It's a year of your restoration. Write it everywhere. It's your year. You are going to see what God is going to do, how God is going to use you. God is going to do wonders. God is going to do miracles in your life. May God bless you. May God bless you. Thank you for listening to this message. And I look forward. I'm very excited about this year, 2022. This is another year. It excites me like 2020, which brought a double portion over my life, which brought a double portion over the church, which brought a double portion in many, many other areas. So this 2022, again, this is a year of double. You know, God restoring. He said, I will double. You will receive a double portion of your land. The restoration is going to be doubled. God is going to double things that is going to restore, like he did with Job. It's a year of doubling. It's a year again of doubling the restoration. May God bless you as we finish this service. God be with you. I want to thank you for listening, for tuning in. As I've said, you know, next year, next week again, 10:30, if you are not with us, just tune in to our Facebook, our Instagram, our YouTube channel. You know, just tune in. God is going to help you. May God bless you. Father, we thank you for this word, Lord God. Thank you for this year of restoration. We thank you, Lord Father, for your greater blessings, the restoration power that God, you are going to give. Restoration of all things in our lives, Lord. Thank you, Father. We bless those that have been listening to your word. Thank you, Father, in the name of Jesus. Amen.